Good evening, I'm Hugh Downs.
And I'm Barbara Walters, and this is 2020.
From ABC News, around the world and into your home, the stories that touch your life, with Hugh Downs and Barbara Walters. This is 2020. And a doctor facing trial.
Are you aware that people think you are a ghoul?
In this cabin, he helped two women commit suicide.
It was tense for me. I was very nervous, uneasy. Nobody can feel good under such circumstances.
And now...
You're indicted for murder. You're being charged with murder.
Dr. Jack Kevorkian, inventor of the suicide machine. Critics ask, who gave him the right to play God? Barbara Walters with the man they call Dr. Death. Those stories tonight, February 14, 1992.
And we begin tonight with a man who has made medical history, but because of it, may spend the rest of his life in prison. He is Dr. Jack Kevorkian, a pathologist and inventor of the so-called suicide machine, and a man who has physically assisted three women to take their own lives. Just today, court proceedings began that could end with Dr. Kevorkian being convicted of murder. Tonight, through his interview with Barbara, we get an exclusive look at who he is and why he does what he does.
Hugh, it's one of the most compelling issues of our time. If patients want to die, should doctors be allowed to help them die? According to the latest national survey, most Americans feel it should be a matter of personal choice. And it's believed that many doctors do help patients die. But only Dr. Kevorkian has created a suicide machine. This is the man, and this is his story. Dr. Jack Kevorkian calls himself an agnostic, but he favors Bach hymns. He plays the organ for his own amusement and said he was nervous playing in front of our camera. That was surprising. You'd think he would be used to cameras by now.
Dr. Kevorkian, do you have any comment tonight?
He rocketed to national attention after he helped this 54-year-old woman commit suicide a year and a half ago. Janet Adkins suffered from Alzheimer's disease, and Kevorkian invented a suicide machine with which she took her own life.
Barbara, the first machine is the original machine used by Janet Adkins. It's all dirty because of the fingerprint powder used by the state police.
Geoffrey Fieger is Dr. Kevorkian's lawyer. To protect his client, Fieger said he'd rather explain how the three solutions in these bottles work.
In the largest bottle is a saline solution.
Harmless.
Totally harmless. The next bottle is the thiopental. That puts the patient to sleep. The third bottle is the sodium potassium and an ectal, and that puts the patient's heart under and ends the life.
The patient starts this machine himself or herself?
Yes, through pushing the button on the side.
After Janet Adkins pushed the button and died, a Michigan judge ordered Kevorkian not to assist in any further suicides. Kevorkian maintained that such assistance was not against state law and said he would defy the judge's ban. Last October 23rd, he did. In a secluded state park, covered this week with a mantle of snow, Kevorkian obliged the wishes of two women who wanted to end their lives. This cabin was where they died. Kevorkian said he used it because he had been turned down every place else. Marjorie Wants was 58 and suffered from an extremely painful pelvic disease. Sherry Miller was 43 and incapacitated with multiple sclerosis. This video was recorded the night before they died.
Sherry, what is it you want? Put it in plain English.
Yeah, I want to die.
That's as plain as you can put it?
Yeah.
I wish we could do it like she said. I wish we could have done it a year ago.
Yeah.
Two years ago.
Marjorie Wants used a suicide machine like the one that killed Janet Adkins. Sherry Miller's veins couldn't take a needle. She breathed from a mask containing carbon monoxide until she could breathe no more. Doctor, after the death of the two women, Mrs. Wants and Mrs. Miller, what did you do?
I did what one has to do by law. I notified the medical examiner's office and the sheriff's department, and I informed them both that there had been a double physician-assisted suicide, and then I had to tell them where it was.
Kevorkian was charged with two counts of murder. At age 63, he faces the possibility of spending the rest of his life in prison, life without parole. When we met this week, I found him both unafraid and outspoken.
Doctor, let me be frank.
Surely.
You're aware that people think you are a ghoul?
Surely.
You're aware that people think this is a horror story?
Sure.
How do you answer it?
That's emotionalism. It's when the heart transplants first came in, that was the same thing. People, many doctors were saying, this is wrong. It's contrary to God's will, contrary to nature. Isn't it ghoulish to rip a person's chest half open to transplant a heart or do a bypass operation?
Let's look into your background a little bit. What brought you to this point? In your experience as a doctor, what interested you in this whole area?
Really, what led me into this was working with condemned criminals on death row who want to donate organs when they're executed, and it isn't allowed. It boggles my mind that society would not allow, and doctors wouldn't do it, to take organs from men who are going to be executed under anesthesia at the time for execution and use those to save five or six other people. This is how I got into this whole field.
Why can't they take the organs immediately after death?
Because some of them would, maybe kidneys if they're taken right there in the chamber, but others can't be used. They've got to be taken as they are today with brain-dead donors. You can artificially create a brain-dead state by putting the prisoner under anesthesia at the time set for execution, so his life is never shortened.
And then you execute them while they're under anesthesia?
Well, they'll die when you take the organs.
I see.
Yes.
One of the biggest complaints against you, even by groups who support euthanasia, is that you have not so far dealt with people who are terminally ill. That is, it has not been proven that they're going to die in a specific time. Mm-hmm. When Janet Atkins told you that she wanted to die, that she had no desire to keep living with Alzheimer's disease, isn't it possible that she was just extremely depressed, that there could have been more months? Mm-hmm. I mean, for you alone to have made that decision, that's what so many people criticize.
Yes, I understand the criticism. It's well taken. But it's not entirely valid.
Well, even if it's a little valid,
well,
I mean, we're talking about death.
Good point. 2,000 miles separated us. If this were legitimate, legalized, so the doctors could do it as a routine service, at least competent doctors, she could have been visited every month, then every week, then every day, until you're sure you're at the point where her mind is going. But we were separated by 2,000 miles. She had been under a new experimental drug, which didn't work, under a psychiatrist's care, and I know personally she wasn't morbidly depressed. And when I talked to her, her memory was slipping very badly, and I had to act then because there was no way I could fine-tune this 2,000 miles apart. For the sake of the patient, I did it.
Of the three women you helped to die, not one was considered terminally ill. So at what point of illness do you feel that you can assist someone?
That is wrong. Multiple sclerosis in one patient was going straight downhill for 11 years. And when she first wrote to me, she could write in a very irregular hand a letter. She couldn't make an X a year and a half later. And that's terminal, because she would have died within 2 or 3 years, maybe. That's terminal. But she would have died totally incapacitated.
What I'm getting at is, where do you make the decision? You, doctor,
yes.
At what point this person should be assisted, and at what point they can have a quality of life so that you would say, I won't do this.
That's a good point. I had to make the decision alone because nobody cooperates with me. Mm-hmm. So I took it on myself for the sake of the patient.
Why don't you just tell your patients how to commit suicide?
Because they're afraid to do it alone. They're afraid to be alone. They're afraid it may misfire and they'll end up worse than before. They all tell me this.
Do you turn patients down? Will you assist anyone who says, I want to die?
I've turned down, I think, 97-98% of the patients who've contacted me.
If you had your choice, mm-hmm. instead of doing this alone and making this decision, an enormous responsibility, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
How would you like to see it done?
Every physician can't do this. That's what's wrong with all the initiative drives and all the plans put forward now. You can't let every doctor do this because some are outright criminal. You can't allow that. It'll be abused. And some doctors don't want to do it by temperament. Some can't do it by religion. So you've got to have certain specialists qualified to do this, to whom a doctor can refer a patient like he does everybody.
And you do not feel that every hospital should have such a machine, and certainly not in the home, unassisted by a physician.
No, every hospital even wouldn't want to have a machine. Does every hospital have a heart transplant unit? You just have a place where they can be referred.
Should there be second opinions?
Well, there has to be second opinions, because this isn't the decision of one or two men or persons.
But there wasn't in your case.
There couldn't be. No one cooperates with you.
In this cabin, on that Wednesday night in October, Kevorkian had no medical help. His sister was present, as were Marjorie Wants's husband and two of Sherry Miller's closest friends. There was no one else around.
Can you tell us what the atmosphere was like in the cabin with you and those two women you helped?
Well, you can imagine how it was. Tense for me. I was very nervous, uneasy. Nobody can feel good under such circumstances. Nobody there felt good at all. By the way, strangely, except the patients. They were the only calm ones there. Everybody else was nervous, edgy, and tense.
Mrs. Wants died first.
Yes, that's right.
I know you can't tell me legally exactly.
No.
But you have that information.
In this case, Marjorie Wants's fingers were attached to strings. One string controlled the administration of the anesthetic. The other string controlled the administration of the potassium chloride. When she fell asleep, her hand dropped, and the potassium chloride entered her body and killed her.
You provided the means to Mrs. Wants' death.
Yes.
You did not yourself physically do it.
Obviously,
no.
He did not.
No.
In the case of Mrs. Miller, who died second, It is said that you put a mask over her face.
That's true.
And the mask allowed her to inject into her body carbon dioxide.
Yes, because she could have taken the mask off at any time if she wanted to. But, more importantly, the carbon monoxide, Barbara, was controlled by her.
It has been said, it has been reported, that when you put the mask on Mrs. Miller's face, that she could not take it off, and this is why it's considered murder.
That's totally untrue.
That's just
and it's just totally untrue.
She had just a little use of one arm and very little use of the fingers. She couldn't put the mask on, but she could easily have taken the mask off. And she also turned on the gas with her own hand.
Do you ever, in the quiet moments of your life, question what you are doing?
No.
These life and death decisions that you alone are making?
No, I'm not making. The patient makes them. I'm here to serve the patient. A doctor is a servant. I serve the patient's need.
Why not wait until the state changes the
law? I didn't break any law. I didn't make that device to have a gimmick or to be different. I made that device because in Michigan, where there is no law against assisting a suicide, is the only way I could do it. I can assist the suicide in the most humane way possible. That's why I made the device, not to be different or have a gimmick.
Not to prove a point?
No, to help a patient.
Are you willing to spend the rest of your life perhaps in prison?
I'm willing to risk it.
Because
but I know if I do, then I'm right. All of society knows I'm not a criminal. Then why do they put me in jail? Because you have dark age mentality in this society.
What do you say to people who say, Dr. Kevorkian, you are playing God?
Well, so is a doctor who takes your heart from one body and puts it in another, isn't he? A doctor always plays God, even when he gives you a pill, because he's interfering with a natural process.
Instead of being called Dr. Death, which does sound so very extreme and so very ghoulish,
yes.
Isn't there something you would prefer being called?
Well, I will one day.
What do you think you will be called then?
They'll call me Dr. Life. You know why? At that time, they'll be taking organs from condemned people, from one human who to be destroyed by your esteemed law, with his permission and wish, or her permission and wish, because we have women on death row, and saving the lives of 5 to 7 people. Then you may call me Dr. Life.
Oh, that's heavy. What is your impression of him personally, though?
I found him honest, outspoken, and warmer, I must say, than I expected. Look, he is a fanatic about what he believes. I should point out, by the way, that he accepts no fees, turns down donations, thinks no one should get paid for this. And whatever happened, if it happens, it will bring attention to the issues. Mm. What do you think?
I don't think he's guilty of murder. He always had witnesses, and the wishes of the patient seem to be honored at all kinds. If he's convicted of murder in a state where what he did is not a crime, you'd worry about justice, I think. He might be guilty of contempt of court, but that's not murder.
By the way, Hugh, he has also heard from criminals, some on death row now, who say, we want to have this done. This is the only way we can serve society is to have the organ donation, which is also part of his thinking.
Fascinating. Thank you, Barbara.